Today on Bizarre Podcast, I'm going to be telling you about a very famous haunting which took place in the UK in 1956 in the very small family home of the Hitchings at 63 Wycliffe Road in Battersea in southwest London. And it took the UK by storm and for a while forced a 15-year-old girl into the eye of the national newspapers. And the strange story of the haunting even reached Parliament. This 15-year-old girl was named Shirley Hitchings, who lived with her father Wally, an underground train driver, a mother Kitty, who was wheelchair-bound, and her grandmother Ethel, and her adopted son John. The house was a two-story structure which was actually being used as two homes, so to speak. The downstairs was home to Shirley and her mother and father Wally and Kitty, whilst upstairs was home to Ethel and John. The family literally lived on top of each other, in the small, contained, but happy little home. But the quiet, calm, happy little home wouldn't last for long. For on the 27th of January 1956, the haunting began. 27th of January 1956. It all started with an ornate, solitary key that seemed to appear out of thin air and manifest of the pillow which sat upon the bed of 15-year-old Shirley Hitchings. As Shirley reached out and took hold of the key, which was around 4 inches in length and silver, she wondered where it had come from, and who had placed it upon her pillow with such purpose. It didn't look like it had been misplaced. It looked as though it had been placed upon the pillow with intent. Shirley at once brought the key to her father, who had no idea what this small silver key unlocked. He at once went around the house and proceeded to try the key in multiple locks, but it either didn't fit or unlock anything in the old Victorian house. That very night, the family experienced strange knocking noises coming from around the house, from within the walls, and sometimes it seemed like it was coming from within the ground, an eerie tapping and knocking that just wouldn't give in. It persisted all through the night, and it only got louder and louder all around the house, so loud in fact that the neighbours started to come knocking on the door, a little upset that they had been awoken at such a late hour. Even the police made an appearance, but unable to find a reason for the sounds, the present was simply pointless. Shirley clung to her father, begging him to make the noises stop. But what could he do? He had no control over the situation, and the noises went on until the early hours of the morning. Over the next couple of days, the noises seemed to become more and more frequent, but there was a pattern developing. Most of the time, the strange noises seemed to start up whenever Shirley would enter the room. It was like the noises followed her around. Well, actually, they did. Shirley started to notice the tapping and the knocking, and the scratching would be ever-present wherever she may go. Whether that be taking a bus ride, or even at her place of work, where she worked as a seamstress. And on a few occasions, she was accused of making the noises herself, and was even blamed for the disappearance of a few pairs of scissors, and was eventually fired from a place of employment. It is not known for certain if the appearance of the strange key was a sign of the paranormal activity which was to come, but for a while the key seemed to have a mind of its own, sometimes being placed in one place and then reappearing on Shirley's pillow once again. And one day, it just simply disappeared, never to be seen again. After reading this, I started to look into the symbolisms of keys, especially in spirituality. First of all, the most obvious symbolism of a key is when you give someone the key to your heart, in a romantic gesture. A key can also symbolise comfort. For example, a key can lock you into your home at night, literally locking out the outside world and possible intruders, giving you peace of mind that you are safe as you sleep. But just as a key can make you feel safe and secure, a key can also make you feel trapped and confined to be locked inside a room against your will. But just like a key can keep you locked up, it can also give you freedom. But I think the most fitting symbolism for a key for today's story is the following. Some believe that a key can symbolise the opening of a door, a spiritual door that stands between the living and the dead. 18th of February 1956. The strange bumps, bangs, knocking and tapping went on, but up until this point nothing had actually moved, unless you count the strange key that liked to mysteriously appear on Shirley's pillow. That is until one day when Shirley dropped a glove upon the floor. As she bent down to grab the glove, it flew up into the air of its own accord with some force and slapped Wally at her father in the face. And a pair of slippers flew up from the floor and found themselves upon a table. The very same pair that would later go for a walk around the house as if some invisible phantom was wearing them upon his feet. They made their way into the hall, followed by a scared but fascinated Shirley, before they stopped dead in their tracks. And it certainly did shake up the family, and nothing could prepare them for the night ahead of them. The back room of the house was what they used as the front room, the living room, where they had a large TV. Well, large for 1956, when a TV set was a luxury, a definite step up from the radio, but make no mistake, money did not come easy to the family, and the house was definitely small and cramped. And as close as they sat to the TV, some nights they struggled to hear the programme over the knocking and scratching noises that seemed to come from all around. In the actual front room of the house, Shirley shared a room with her parents. Her small bed was placed next to her mother and father's. This was due to Shirley sleepwalking, and so they all slept in one room with the door locked at night. That night, the family were finding it very hard to sleep, as all the tapping continued to come from the floor, the walls, and even the bed that Shirley lay upon. As Shirley lay there in the darkness, trying in vain to fall asleep, she noticed that her bedsheets were being pulled from her bed. She tried to pull them back, but they continued to be pulled the opposite way. Her mother and father asked that she raise her arm so they could be sure Shirley was not somehow moving the bedsheets. And it was clear she wasn't, especially when her whole body went rigid and arched like a bow, and she seemed to levitate at least 6 inches above the mattress. A shocked father grabbed her and took her from the bed and placed her upon the ground, as a sheet flew from Shirley's bed onto her parents, and Shirley collapsed onto the floor. Over the next couple of days, the paranormal activity continued, and the knocking became so loud that the neighbours thought that they would do a little knocking of their own, as they came knocking upon the door of the family to complain.
20th of February, 1956. The activity had now gone from some eerie bumps and bangs to actual levitation of objects that would float into the air and fly off at incredible speeds, normally towards somebody or at a wall. At this point, most people knew about the strange goings-on inside the house, including the neighbours and the landlord, and it wasn't long before the national newspapers heard about the terrifying poltergeist that the family had affectionately named Charlie Boy or Spooky Willie. And the newspapers came away with the sensational stories of chairs being knocked over by unforeseen forces, clocks flying from the mantelpiece, and of course the slippers that like to fly or walk around the house. One of the reporters suggested asking Spooky Willie some simple questions. The poltergeist could answer with one tap for yes, two for no, and three for I don't know. The reporter asked, "Are you evil?" The response was, "No." The reporter then asked, "Can we help you in any way?" The response was, "Yes." The reporter then asked, "Have you a message for Shirley?" The response was, "Yes." The reporter then asked, "Will you deliver it today?" The response was, "No." The reporter then asked, "Tomorrow?" The response was, "No." The reporter then asked, "On Sunday?" And the response was, "Yes." The reporter then went on to ask, "How old was Shirley?" "15 knocks. Shirley was 15 years of age. Now this is where the story gets a little bit muddled. Through more questioning, it was discovered that the spirit was Shirley's dead grandmother. And then the story changed, and now the spirit was that of a young boy who played with Shirley a few years back when Shirley was younger, and the little boy was named Donald. The reporter came to the conclusion through the knocks that once a young boy had moved away overseas, he had died on the journey. This once again turned out to be false. There was indeed a little boy who used to live next door called Donald who Shirley played with, but the little boy moved away from the area with his parents overseas. And it didn't take long to confirm that the boy was indeed alive and well. But from this day, the poltergeist would be known as Donald regardless, and the name Spooky Willie and Charlie Boy faded into obscurity. Although it's worth mentioning, Shirley claims that the name given to the poltergeist didn't come from the childhood friend, but a very fiery, feisty, angry duck named Donald. Donald Duck. Regardless, from this point on, the poltergeist would be called Donald. The reporter was also responsible for creating a fabricated love story between Donald and Shirley, which you might say is downright cruel, but of course Shirley claims that this was never the case and it was all imaginative storytelling by the newspapers. At some point, Ethel, Shirley's grandmother, was also interviewed. The thing we need to remember about Ethel is that she was a stern, strong-headed Irish woman who didn't think it was wise to communicate with the spirit. She did, however, claim to have seen strange things whilst working as a nurse. this including witnessing the souls of the patients leave their body behind, and the ghost of a dead husband that visited her after his death and stood eerily at the bottom of her bed. As well as the newspapers, a self-claimed medium named Harry Hanks, a friend of Wally's from work, arrived to help in any way he could, by trying to make contact through his spiritual gift. Wally was reluctant at first, but quickly warmed to the idea after the activity started to get worse. Apart from a few knockings here and there, in response to questions, very little was established about the activity. Donald remained a mystery. 21st of February, 1956. It wasn't only the newspapers who wanted Shirley's story. The BBC wanted to get in on the story as well, and an interview was arranged to take place that very day at the BBC studios. Shirley must have been exhausted due to the activity carrying on through the night, just as Donald promised. You see, Shirley had asked Donald earlier, before bed, if he planned to behave himself tonight and let them rest, and he responded with three sets of two knocks, which meant no, no, no. And he was as good as his word. Throughout the night, the knocks got louder and louder. Shirley's glove would once again find itself flying across the room, and the bedsheets would be tugged away from underneath her body. Apparently, Donald also liked to lie upon the bed, across her legs. Sleep simply wasn't going to be an option. Even Shirley's grandmother did not escape the disturbances as a chair in Ethel's bedroom overturned in the dead of night. Despite all this, Shirley did make it to the BBC studios to appear on a TV show named Highlight. Shirley had her interview in front of the bright lights of the studio and told her terrifying story, but unfortunately Donald refused to put on a show and was unusually quiet compared to normal. By now, the story of the poltergeist at 63 Wycliffe Road had become a national sensation. It wasn't only the newspapers that wanted to get the story about Donald, but the general public, who wanted to experience the haunted for themselves, even going as far as jumping the wall into the back garden of the Hitchings. The family started to feel very claustrophobic and angry by all the attention, and they desperately wanted Donald to be gone. The family friend Harry Hanks returned on the scene with hopes of communicating with the spirit. Now, at this point in history, spiritualism was quite big. The Ouija board had been on the market since the late 1800s and was seen as an effective, but not recommended way to contact the dead, and Wally and Kitty were dead against the use of a Ouija board in their home. So Harry Hanks decided to simply write out letters of the alphabet, and using the knocking system, Donald would actually spell out words in response to the questions given to him. Although it must be said, Donald was not the best when it came to spelling, but the messages, 9 times out of 10, seemed to make sense. 22nd of February, 1956. Harry Hanks was making some progress, but he insisted that the next step was to hold a seance at his home in Stockwell, an attempt to rid Shirley of Donald the Poltergeist once and for all, to exorcise the disruptive spirit. Shirley's parents were not keen on the idea, but Hanks was very persuasive, and the press also supported the idea, but I imagine it was just to sell newspapers, and I don't actually think Harry Hanks had Shirley's best interests at heart, as it was himself who invited the press. I'm thinking he saw an opportunity and manipulated the affair slightly. The seance took place in Harry's front room. The light shut out, and a circle formed around Shirley. Crammed like sardines into the front room was Hanks, his wife and his daughter, who was in her 20s, Wally, and a clairvoyant and a spiritualist, as well as photographers and reporters. Hanks quickly put himself into a trance, and his face seemed to change, and he attempted to make contact. However, all of a sudden, there was a loud banging at the door. Bang, bang, bang. Now, I can imagine it must have made a few people jump, but this wasn't the banging of an angry poltergeist banging on the walls. No, this was the sound of the police banging on the front door. Someone had tipped off the police that a black magic ritual was underway in the home of Harry Hanks. The police entered and was eventually convinced that the seance was breaking no law and was by no means black magic, and eventually they left. Hanks continued the exorcism, shaking and trembling and using a booming voice that he claimed was the voice of his spirit guide. He proclaimed aloud that Donald was now gone. The exorcism was successful, and there was a certain calm after the seance, and it did indeed seem that Donald had indeed gone for good. Unfortunately, that was not the case. The haunting was about to get a lot worse.
The very next day, two reporters arrived and they claimed that Shirley's brother John had gave them permission to take Shirley to a doctor and to answer some questions. But John most definitely did not give permission. He knew nothing about it. But to make Shirley feel more at ease, they gave her sweets and fizzy pop to gain her trust. Shirley was fooled by the reporters and she went along with them anyway, in what I class an extremely disturbing thing to do with a young teen. To manipulate her like that is disgusting. Whilst with the reporter, Shirley was asked many questions and they actually experienced some strange tapping and knocking that seemed to be coming from Shirley herself. But they were not convinced it was anything supernatural. One of the reporters claimed that the sound seemed to be coming from Shirley's feet. And when they asked her to remove her boot, the tapping stopped at once. Upon further inspection, it seemed that Shirley had a mild deformity of her big toe. This deformity is called hammer toe, a condition where normally the second or third toe can bend or curl downwards due to the middle joint becoming more flexible. It was a reporter's opinion that Shirley could actually make her toe produce a loud clicking, cracking noise that they believe was a tapping and rapping that was supposedly coming from the poltergeist. Of course, at the time of the interview, Shirley had no idea why they wanted her to remove her boot. And when they asked her to pose for photographs holding the boot up, she simply did so. She was tired and hungry and simply wanted to go home. Shirley claims that when she eventually did arrive home, the activity started back up with a vengeance. First of all, the house seemed to come alive with the sounds of knocks, bumps and bangs. And at around 11 p.m. that night, objects started to be thrown around the house, such as a photo frame and slippers. Some of the objects were even launched at Ethel, Shirley's grandmother. This paranormal activity was followed up by a small fire that started in the front bedroom, setting the bedsheets alight. But luckily, it was quickly put out. On another occasion, Shirley's watch fell from her wrist. She picked it up and fastened the strap to find moments later it had simply disappeared. It was clear to the family it was a poltergeist who had took the watch, and so Shirley's father called out for Donald to return it at once. It wasn't long before pieces of the watch started to fall at his feet, but not all the pieces of the watch. Shirley's father then threatens to call the police. This bit actually did make me laugh, the fact that Shirley's father was threatening a poltergeist with the police, and the poltergeist actually responds by returning the watch, even if it is in pieces. You see, the poltergeist returned more pieces of the watch, and he dropped them at Wally's feet. But the metal surround and strap were still missing, so Wally makes one more threat. And then the rest of the watch appears, although the metal surround was said to be bent. A few days later, a story appeared in the Weekend Mail, and the headline was the following: Spook was in girl's big toe. The article was written in such a way to suggest that the haunting was a big hoax, and the tapping noises that were supposed to be coming from Donald the Poltergeist were actually coming from Shirley's big toe, whether she was aware of it or not. The paper said she may have been doing it subconsciously. The article also said that Shirley's mind was filled with horrific stories that she had become fascinated with, like certain TV shows and her grandmother's ghost stories of a dead husband at the bottom of her bed. And Shirley had taken all of this in and had convinced herself of the haunting and subconsciously made the clicking, cracking noises with her hammer toe deformity, which was only possible when she wore her boots. To this day, Shirley insists that it is ridiculous that this story was written and that the reporters actually witnessed Donald throwing piles of papers from the desk, and yet it was never mentioned in the article. Shirley was now seen as a liar in the public eye and shamed in front of the nation. Who would want to help the family now rid them of Donald the Poltergeist, now that Shirley had been made out to be a liar? Well, there was one man who desperately wanted to help the family. He wanted nothing in return for his services. After all, being a paranormal researcher wasn't his full-time job. He actually worked down at the tax office. So, the paranormal research side was more of a hobby. He had a genuine fascination with the paranormal and had become fascinated with this particular case. And on the 6th of March 1956, he arrived on the doorstep of 63 Wycliffe Road, raised a hand and knocked upon the door. And when the door swung open, he introduced himself as Mr. Harold Chibbitt. Harold Chibbitt was born on February the 19th, 1900, in Islington, North London. He was a very curious man who had a fascination with all things paranormal and also liked a touch of science fiction. Quite fitting, as the two, I think, actually go hand in hand. He was a very imaginative man and put his talents to use by writing many science fiction stories when he became a member of the London Science Fiction Club. Harold loved investigating strange paranormal activity, and his investigations made it possible for him to interview people such as the occultist Aleister Crowley and other people, people who all shared his passion or indeed harnessed a special gift. He even became the founder of The Probe, which was a British group of investigators of psychic and occult phenomena. And the case of the strange poltergeist named Donald that had thrown the Hitchings family into their very own horror movie was a case that interested him very much. But Harold wasn't after fame and fortune. He wasn't after the attention of the press. His interest was genuine. If anything, all Harold wanted was the truth. And if he ever had the opportunity to debunk something, he would. The truth was always more important to him. At first, the Hitchings were a bit apprehensive. After all, they had people knocking day and night, claiming that they can help, claiming that they can talk to spirits. Harold Chibbitt made no such claim. His intent was to investigate and try to make contact. He gave no guarantee that he could, but he did have a lot of experience in the matter, and this eased the family into trusting Harold. His investigation, of course, would have to be from the start of the haunting, and there was so much he had missed out on. After all, the tabloids were hardly the best source for information. He needed to hear it from the horse's mouth, so to speak. And so the family invited him into the kitchen, where they sat around the table, and he listened intently as the family retold the story that started with a solitary key. He was a little late to the party, and he had already missed so much. 8th of March, 1956. Over the last few days, the activity was ongoing. Shirley awoke one morning to find her watch was completely crushed on her bedside table. A clock and two photos were found on a mat in front of the fire in the kitchen, and a ball was witnessed flying through the air, thrown by an invisible force. And of course, the tapping and knocking was ever present, along with strange scratching sounds. But it was on the 8th of March that Donald started to request a one-man audience from a reporter that had actually visited in the past, a reporter named Michael Kirch. The messages from the poltergeist were tapped out and made into words and said the following: "Get Kirch. I like to get Kirch on his own. I teach him a lesson. I poke him. I come with message later. I get revenge on Kirch. Suffocate him tonight. Save him if you like. I warn you, get him tonight for safety." There was a few days of relentless activity, such as a levitating fire poker, the bed shaking, the reappearance of a missing gold cross on a chain, and the disappearance of Shirley's favourite pen. And Donald's tapping evolved into tapping out a tune for the family to sing along to. Donald started requesting another reporter's presence by the name of Ronald Maxwell. The family took down persistent tapped-out messages throughout the night. "Get Maxwell. Kirch is no good. I will set house afire if you don't get Maxwell, so take care." This was followed by three strange balls of light that floated through the air in front of the family. Later on that night, the head of a match was struck by Donald, and the match slowly floated through the air towards Shirley. When it reached her, it fell to the ground and slightly burned her eyebrows on the way down. In the early hours, another message was tapped out: "Get Maxwell. I just give you taste of what I am going to do, so get Maxwell. I warn you, no one will stop me." It's at this point in the story when the activity seemed to turn quite nasty, when the family found that their bed sheets on the front room bed had burst into flames. Shirley's father, Wally, suffered a large gash and a nasty burn whilst trying to put out the fire. It's believed that the cut on Wally's arm could have been made by the poltergeist, but we cannot be sure of this. Over the next couple of nights, Shirley goes to stay at her Aunt Nell's house to have a break from the whole nightmare, but as we have established, wherever Shirley goes, Donald would follow. The first night at Aunt Nell's was quite calm, apart from a few knocking and tapping here and there. The day after, Shirley initially returned to her home at number 63, but by request of Donald, she returned to Aunt Nell's, and that night, Donald was more active, tapping out messages for Aunt Nell to take down. Donald tells Aunt Nell to not fear him. He is here to guard them. That night, Aunt Nell did not sleep well. Her bedsheets were pulled from the bed, and objects were thrown all around the room. The very next day, to Aunt Nell's relief, I'm sure, Shirley returned home. 17th of March, 1956. Joyce Lewis was a reporter for the South London Advertiser, and she was invited to stay the night in Shirley's bed and experience the paranormal activity for herself, and she brought with her John Heal, another reporter, to stand watch outside of the door. That night, as Joyce and Shirley get ready for bed, Joyce asks if she may restrain Shirley with insulating tape on her hands and feet, to rule out the possibility that Shirley was actually responsible for the paranormal activity. And Shirley agreed, and she was taped up quite securely, and they both settled in for the night. But a good night's sleep was simply not going to happen. As they settled down for bed, all at once there was a terrible scraping noise that came from underneath the bed. It startled Joyce, and Shirley assured her that everything was okay, and this was just the beginning. Just after midnight, the undersheets of the bed started to rise up of their own accord, and as Joyce pulled them back down, they were quickly pulled back with forceful tug by invisible hands. A few minutes later, after Joyce had remade the bed, the scraping sound started up again, but this time it seemed even louder, and it sounded like it was coming from the head of the bed. The next thing they feel is an icy draft that flows above their feet, and their bed sheets are yanked away from the bed. As the hour nears 1 a.m, Joyce is overcome by the sweet smell of violets that then suddenly changed to a foul smell, not unlike burning rubber. At around 1:20 a.m, Shirley tells Joyce that she has been scratched on her leg. May I remind you at this point that she is taped up and Joyce was actually holding Shirley's hands and feet with her own. When Joyce examines Shirley's leg, she does indeed see scratch marks. At around 1:30 a.m, Shirley has fallen asleep. Of course, Joyce is still awake when there is an almighty bang on the bed that scared her half to death. Strangely, Shirley sleeps through this, even when the bed starts to shake and bounce. At 2:05 a.m, Joyce can feel Donald tickling her ankle, and when she objects, the bed sheets are once again pulled from the bed. At 2:30, Joyce notices that Shirley, who was asleep at the time, is being pulled by the arm out of the bed. Joyce grabs onto Shirley and tries in vain to pull her back into the bed. Shirley awakes at this point, half in and half out of the bed. At around 4 a.m, after a few more hours of tapping, scratching and sheet pulling, they decide to have a tea break. At 4:30 a.m, they are back in bed, and it isn't long before Shirley cries out that someone is touching her feet, and it feels like a strange sensation around her big toe. When they take a look, they discover that Donald has tied a piece of string around Shirley's big toe. This makes them laugh. Shortly after, an exhausted Joyce decided that she had had enough, and she left the house with her story. In the article, Joyce Lewis and John Heal, the second reporter who had been there the whole night, outside the room, were quite convinced that there was definitely something very strange going on at number 63. For the next few days, the activity increased and the tap-tap messages became more and more sinister and unsettling, and on occasion, the messages would have to be translated from French into English. One of these words were La Manche, which was translated by Chibbett. La Manche translated into channel, as in the English channel. This will make more sense a little later. A lot of the messages seem to be nonsense and make no sense, such as, I will do harm to anyone who don't believe in flying saucers, and I come from the atmosphere. Harold Chibbett was curious if the entity could be something other than a poltergeist, maybe it was alien in nature. So Harold asked about space travel and life on other planets, and Donald was more than happy to respond by telling Harold that there was indeed life on Mars, Saturn and Venus. But space travel wasn't the topic of conversation for long when Donald started to make more threats, such as, I will set fire to Nan's bed in night, ready for fire, you don't think I do it? The same night, the family discovered the electric stove had been turned on not once, but twice. Even after being unplugged, the switch was still flipped. The next day, more messages came. You made me angry. I set fire. You can't stop me. You almost die. No escape now. I do not kid. Get out of home for tonight. I set atomic gas off. The next day, pieces of burnt paper are found under Ethel's bed. All of this threatening behaviour went on and on, which included more levitation of objects like a bottle of milk that was thrown at Shirley. Apart from the increase of threats, the activity was nothing new really, but that was all about to change when Donald started to communicate in a brand new way. 22nd of March 1956. It was on this day that Shirley discovered that Donald had actually written her a message by using a blue ballpoint pen and a notebook. The writing was scribbled and was almost unreadable and quite unnerving and downright creepy. The note read, Shirley, I come, my Shirley. In fact, in the future, Donald would start to write many letters to the family with strange requests and strange information. But Harold Chibbett could not be sure that Shirley wasn't the one writing the letters, so he placed a pen and writing pad in a room and locked the door and left for the night. On his return to number 63 the next day, he would find nearly 60 letters had been written or scribbled by the poltergeist. Harold kept hold of the key all night, so there was no way for anyone from the family to enter the room, unless, of course, they had a spare key or somehow got in through a window. But Harold couldn't find any sign anywhere that anyone had entered the room, apart from the letters, of course. Even though Donald had started writing letters, he actually did go back to his old method of tapping from time to time. And on one particular occasion, he insisted that Shirley go and sleep at her Aunt Nell's house in peace. Shirley did so, and she got a good night's rest, uninterrupted, the best night's sleep she had had for a while. However, the next day, the threats once again picked up, and once again Donald demanded the presence of a certain reporter, like Maxwell, and when the family decided not to play to the whims of the poltergeist, more threats came, like Donald threatened to set the house on fire once again, and he also said that he came to destroy the house, and this time he won't fail. Now, the following all happened over the coming weeks, and it can get a bit repetitive, so I'll just list some of the things that happened. The next night, Donald demands that Shirley sleep with her grandmother, but Ethel wasn't going to be told what to do by anybody, not even a ghost, and she said sternly that that wasn't going to happen. Donald didn't like this one bit, and via the tapping system, the following threatening, insulting messages were taken down. The first message was Donald threatening that if Shirley did not sleep with her grandmother, then he would not leave the family alone. He then said he would tip Nan out of bed. Let's go get silly old cow up. Silly old bugger. She is old battle axe. He even insulted her nose, saying it looked like an overgrown beetroot. These rude insulting messages to our Shirley's grandmother carried on for the next few days. Just like the written letters, Donald also started to be audible, although it was few and far between. On one occasion, Aunt Nell's husband's missing cufflinks reappeared. When Aunt Nell asked Donald if he was responsible for the return of the cufflinks, a faint yes was heard, as though it floated in the air. At this point, Donald was so active that the family had actually started to sleep on the kitchen floor, where they actually felt more safe for some reason. After more communication with Donald, it was established that he wasn't the only entity that liked to visit the family. There was probably 3 to 4 entities, two of which were called Mickey and Dopey. And according to Donald, when they made their presence known, Donald had to leave because they used his power. On one occasion, Donald warned the family that Mickey and Dopey were going to start a fire and then informed them that he would have to leave. Donald returned the next day and told the family that the two entities had now left. There was no fire started in the house that night, but on other occasions, Donald would threaten to set the house on fire unless this was an entity pretending to be Donald. The activity for the longest time carried on in this manner, threatening to set the house on fire, making a mess by throwing objects, or making the beds, ornaments overturned, and bizarre requests that Shirley sleep with her grandmother, and even make contact with a childhood friend Donald, the child Shirley played with, from next door, before he moved away overseas. After more threats to start a fire, eventually there was a fire started on the stove in the kitchen. The electricity was actually turned off, but was mysteriously turned back on, and old rags were burnt up on the stove. Now this fire did actually cause a small amount of damage to the kitchen, and the family did make a claim on the insurance. On the form, when asked about the cause of the fire, it simply read, poltergeist. The police eventually got involved once again, insisting that Shirley see a psychologist, otherwise she may be taken into care. Shirley was given medication, and she refused to take it. It was seen that Donald also didn't agree with the medication. One day, all the pills that had been subscribed to Shirley were found dissolving in a pudding bowl full of water on the kitchen table. And once again, Shirley insisted it wasn't her doing. Harold Chibbitt was now a regular visitor. He would arrive on the scene every week or so to take down all the information of the haunting. Harold Chibbitt was a welcomed addition to the case. He brought with him a sense of calm. He believed the only way to get rid of the spirit was to communicate with it and to find out what it wanted. But at the same time, he did consider the possibilities that Shirley or a family member were responsible for the haunting and did all he could to make sure that he wasn't being made a fool out of. Donald's constant demands for the reporters was a regular part of the haunting now, claiming that if the reporters came, then he would reveal his true identity. Donald also seemed obsessed with arranging a reunion with Shirley and the child Donald who once lived next door, possibly a romantic reunion. And for some reason, Donald sometimes liked to communicate in French. And on occasion, Donald had actually claimed that he came from France, and he was born in 1798, and that he had drowned when young. In his own words, when he was 15, possibly meaning 15. And then there's a reference to the English Channel. Was it possible Donald drowned as a child in the English Channel? And Donald also mentioned the French word, and you'll have to excuse me here if I pronounce this wrong, dolphin, which was French for dolphin, but could also mean, in a nutshell, heir to the throne. From all of this, Harold Chibbitt came up with the wild notion that Donald could be some kind of French royalty. The thing is, Donald, or whatever entity was coming through at this particular time, just couldn't be trusted. But they could only go off the messages that were received. Now this may seem like some kind of big breakthrough, and Harold Chibbitt certainly did believe that. But bear this in mind, as well as French, the entity also claimed to speak, are you ready? Martian. So as you can imagine, it was hard to establish an identity, but the connection with France was ever present and it did come across more than once. Even going as far as to tapping out the song Ferrero Jacques, and even describing his appearance in life. He said he was 5 foot high, he had fair hair, blue eyes, and he said he was 34 inches wide. I'm guessing he meant chest size. Eventually, sometime in April, the reporter Kirch returned to the house as Donald requested many times. But frustratingly, Donald refused to communicate. Directly after the visit, the activity started up again, and it was starting to take its toll on Shirley's grandmother, who was tired of the constant visits from the reporters and the public, and the random fires and the flying objects, as well as the constant demands that Shirley sleep in her bed, and almost falling down the stairs after being pushed on many occasions. But there was one incident that probably made Ethel think enough was enough, and that was when she heard the voice of her dead mother speaking to her. Possibly a cruel prank by Donald, or whatever entity was communicating that day. She decided to move out of the property and go and live with her other daughter, and you would think that this would have pleased the poltergeist, when in fact, Donald demanded that Ethel return. And of course, when she didn't, Donald started to show his anger by tipping paint onto Shirley's leg, throwing items around the house, and threats to set fires started up again, followed by burning embers found on the floor. Donald would later insist that it wasn't him causing the trouble, but it was due to the arrival of a new entity named Old Shaggy Roots, and Donald insisted he was here to protect the family. Sadly, not long after this, Shirley's grandmother had a stroke and passed away in hospital. 15th of May, 1956. Harold had been piecing the French connections together and had a wild theory that Donald may have been the first son of Louis XVI. When asked, Donald confirmed that this was true, so Harold came up with the conclusion that the poltergeist, Donald, may well have been Louis XVII, who died whilst imprisoned, and died in 1795, 2 years after his father's execution during the French Revolution. He died at the age of 10. There have been a few conspiracy theories as to if the young prince actually did escape captivity. With this theory in Harold's mind, he came up to the conclusion that Donald may well have been the young heir to the throne and could possibly have drowned out in the English Channel, trying to escape. I'll admit, this seems a little stretched. I feel that most of the information given by Donald was very jumbled and sometimes downright strange. For example, none of this actually added up with the dates Donald had given in the past. He once claimed he was born in 1798, 3 years after the death of Louis XVII, who Donald was now claiming to be. On one occasion, Donald provided a connection between himself and the theatre, even going as far as to including names from the theatre, names of people that actually existed. At the time, this seemed like a breakthrough. It seemed like the poltergeist had provided information that was actually relevant. This is until a TV guide was found with the names of the theatre actors inside, something Shirley could have quite easily obtained, or even watched the play on TV. And if she was responsible for the tapping noises, she could have passed on this information from the TV guide. Now there is the other possibility that the family wasn't dealing with one entity but many. After all, Donald had already mentioned three other entities, Mickey, Dopey, and Old Shaggy Roots. And as time went on, he also included James Dean, the actor who died in a car wreck in 1955. The haunting went on like this for the rest of the year, from month to month, constantly uninterrupted. 1956, the first year, seems to be the most active year. That's why I've been reading out the dates, to give you a sense of how much occurred between such a small period of time. The following year of 1957 was still very active, but there were noticeable periods of time where the activity just didn't happen for months. But there was no mistaking that Donald was still there. And it was like this up until 1964, when the family moved into a new house, and of course Donald followed them. Through the years, Shirley found it hard to actually bring a boyfriend home. Some even ran away from the house in terror as Donald made his presence known to Shirley's new suitor. She claims to this day that the poltergeist stole her teenage years. But in 1964, Shirley met her now husband Derek, and they both moved away to the South Coast in 1957. But this time, Donald decided to stay with the rest of the family. But Shirley did still receive messages from Donald now and again, informing her what her parents were up to back home, and vice versa. In 1968, Kitty received the last letter from Donald, simply saying, "I'm leaving." And that was that. That was the end of the haunting. Donald had simply vanished, just as he had mysteriously appeared. In a strange turn of events, Kitty actually started to miss Donald. It felt like something was missing from her life, and she couldn't help but mourn the ghostly visitor that had hung around for 12 years. She was actually quite upset, although the rest of the family were quite happy about it. Years later, in the 1980s, while Shirley was attending a craft fair, she was approached by a medium who informed her that she had a spirit of a small boy in a blue suit with red hair following her around, and he had a message to give her. The message was, "I'm sorry for all the trouble I caused." This came to a shock to Shirley. You see, years earlier, Harold Chibbert was actually visiting France when he found a postcard. Upon the postcard was a picture of the young Prince Louis, and he posted this to Shirley and her family. On the postcard, the young prince had a blue suit on, blue eyes, and a head full of strawberry blonde hair.